I've been saying. But thank you all very much. We'll have some questions in a minute. I'll try and answer them if I can. I just put up on this last slide to show you some of the topics we were talking about there was this idea of worship of Christ in the New Testament period, and particularly this idea, how does that work in a Jewish context where they're monotheists? How do they understand Christ as God if they're monotheists? And so there's been lots of really interesting studies recently. A good place to start, if you're interested in that topic, is Dunn's book, James Dunn's book, as a kind of nice starting point. And then the others by Hurtado and Richard Balcombe, kind of interesting topics. It just opens you out into bigger kind of theological questions, really, not just Revelation, but other texts that they look at there. So I'll try and pricey some of these questions and see. You might see by my face, so I'll think, oh my God, I can answer these. Let's see what I can do. I'll maybe read some as well. So someone asked, the apocalypse seems to see most of the world as bad and to be destroyed. Paul, in Romans 8, sees the whole creation as being freed from its slavery to corruption. If the author of the apocalypse knew of Romans 8, do you think he could have viewed it as consistent with his own visions? So that's quite a hard question, isn't it, to start with. It is tricky. I think it is very tricky with the book of Revelation. At the end, in the final chapters, you get this vision of a new heaven and a new earth. And as I said, what you get in that new heaven and a new earth is it's neither like heaven was before or earth was before, because those kind of two spaces have broken down. You don't have heaven and earth as separate anymore. You just have where God dwells with his people. There is much debate about that in terms of the book of Revelation, how you understand it. And in particular, to what extent is there continuity between the present creation and the new creation? Is it a transformation of the present creation being transformed to become new, or is it kind of destroyed and then replaced by something else? So there's a lot of debate about that. And so depending on how that's interpreted, it can be seen as consistent with Paul, this idea of being transformed, becoming new, if you read Revelation in that way. But it certainly does impact, particularly on, this may be a bit too broad brush, but kind of evangelical kind of theologians who worry that, in a sense, what you've got is the old creation's passing away, so why bother doing anything ecological, because you're just going to get a new one. And so it can be quite detrimental to various things in that area. And as I mentioned, Simon Woodman is a scholar, a Baptist minister, who's trying to retrieve Revelation as an ecological text. He's written quite a bit on that. And there's another student in Wales who's writing on it as more of a hazardous text, as a green hazardous text. So I think it's certainly a debated issue. I think Revelation can be read as seeing the present creation transformed to become new. So there's continuity and the importance of retaining that. So that's, I think I would maybe try and push that line a little bit in terms of seeing consistency with Paul, rather than just seeing the present creation as negative. And you've also got the line in somewhere in chapter 11, it talks about God destroying those who destroy the earth. So that's often picked up as being quite strong from an ecological perspective. Okay. Do you reckon I got away with that one? As an answer. Oh yes. So someone's now talking here about the image of the in chapter one, really, of the vision of the Son of Man. Dressed in a white robe, and then chapters 2 and 3, where he tells the seer to write down what he says in the vision to the churches. And how does that relate to what I've been talking about this kind of movement or shifting or blending in the different in the different images, really? I think that touches on a very complex question in terms of inspiration. How is kind of scripture inspired, and how does that work? I think certainly my sense would be that any author, say the author of the Book of Revelation, being inspired, yet he was nonetheless informed by his own context. Although he's inspired in the Spirit to write these texts, you can see someone informed and enriched by the Old Testament prophecies, by those images that he already has as a kind of store of images. So I would see that sense of, although someone may be inspired by the Spirit to write, they're nonetheless informed by their own context, by the scriptural text they already know. And so certainly I would encourage people to read the Old Testament as a background to understand the imagery you get within the Book of Revelation. That would be my answer to that one. Someone asked about, in chapter 6, verse 6, about the, suddenly we get talk about the price of wheat and barley, suddenly comes into it. And I think that this is an image in chapter 6, you know, the four horsemen of the apocalypse. And it's an image of famine, that the prices are going up so much. So it's an image, obviously we then need to translate that into kind of monetary terms that make sense to us, but the idea is that the prices have gone through the roof because there's a famine going on. So that's what's going on there. It's part of that imagery of death and famine and destruction that's going on. Quite a hard one. This is to do with resurrection bodies. I'm not sure I can answer this, really. In terms of when people are resurrected, what's the resurrection body like? Do they come back at the same age or in the same form as they were? I mean, in the Book of Revelation, it really doesn't say very much about this. If I'm talking about the Book of Revelation, we've got an odd passage in chapter 6 about the souls of the righteous under who've been martyred, who've been butchered under the altar, talking about psuche, souls, as opposed to souls and bodies. So it doesn't talk a lot about the resurrected body or what it's like. Paul does. Again, we had an earlier question about Paul. I mean, I think the main point, partly would be, I don't know the answer particularly, but the key thing I think would be that Paul always talks about, when he was talking to the Corinthians, in 1 Corinthians, is don't confuse the body you have now with the resurrected body. It's going to be transformed, it's going to be different, it's going to be glorified. It's more like the resurrected body of Christ than the body you have now. So although there'll be continuity, there'll also be change and transformation. So I think I would emphasise that. But it's not just a case of coming back exactly as you are. You're going to be transformed, transformable. This is a someone asking about a particular book. Some of you may have come across this, Scott Hahn, called The Lamb's Supper, where he explains the Mass through the Apocalypse. I think it's an interesting book. I think he overdoes it, would be my summary. I think he makes too much. Much of it, and he absolutely overdoes the puns. By the end, you were just reeling by the amount of puns in the chapter headings. I think there's something there. I mean, what you can see some of the topics I pick up here today, I think there's a really close connection between liturgy and worship and what's going on in the Book of Revelation. But I don't think it's as simple as saying what we get in the Book of Revelation is a first century kind of Eucharist or Eucharist. I think what you get within the Book of Revelation are elements of Jewish liturgy, temple liturgy, kind of worship on the Lord's Day. I think it's a mix of different things. I think it's not just that one element. So I'd definitely say, like any book, it's always worth having a read of Scott Hahn and Lamb's Supper, but I think he's got a particular thesis, and I think he would maybe, I wouldn't be fully persuaded by it. I think there's an interesting idea, but I think he over-eggs it, my summary. So that's that one. Obviously, you know, I don't want to downgrade other scholars. I do read, it's a very interesting text, but I think, for me, I think he maybe overdoes it. In terms of a health warning on reading the Book of Revelation, just some of the images can lead to misleading teaching, and other different images we might use. I think like any text within Scripture, the key thing is that people read it. Because the danger is we leave certain texts and don't look at them because they seem a bit weird, a bit odd, and then we just leave them to the crazy people, and then they're the only ones who read it. So I think the non-crazy people should read it too and see that there's lots of very interesting and rich theology in these texts, and that you do have to struggle with them, the same as you do with Daniel or Zechariah or any of the Old Testament prophets. They're not easy to read, but it doesn't mean it's not worth doing. So I would encourage people to read it with good commentaries like the Ian Boxall type book, sensible, sane people who can help guide you through it, and not just leave something aside because it seems difficult. So I think although it can seem a bit shocking, the more you get into the imagery, the more you can see actually there's a richness there and a depth to the theology that's more than just kind of monsters and violence going on. I think that's what I would say to that one. Aren't all the heavenly mysteries that we need to know already revealed to Jesus through the Gospels, by Jesus through the Gospels? I mean, in a sense, this the idea of is it saying something different or contrary to the Gospels? There was a whole debate for a long time about the Book of Revelation and its status within the New Testament. And the whole idea is within the New Testament texts, they're kind of harmonious, they kind of cohere with one another. So it's not so much that it's saying something we haven't maybe heard before, but it's saying it in a new way, in a different way. So although it's disclosing heavenly mysteries, I mean, certainly the way I read it, it's all about love of God and love of neighbour. So And that's not a new message. That's in the rest of the New Testament too. It's about worshipping God. It's about imitating Christ, living in that way. So I think it's the same message. It's just phrased differently. Is it a revelation of the past or the contemporary or the future? And that's the whole thing. Particularly lots of dispensationalist people, they really worry about this. About is it a preterist or a futurist or something, way of reading the text. And it's more complicated than that, because if you look at the Book of Revelation itself, it's not one or other of those anyway. There's elements, for example, if you look at the letters to the seven churches, on one level it's talking to people living back in the first century in Laodicea and Smyrna and Pergamum, but it's also got something resonant for people of all ages, so it's not an either or. I think the way that particularly kind of Christian Catholic tradition have read scripture down the ages, it's not an either or. It may have an original historical context, but it doesn't mean it can't continue to speak to us down the ages in new ways. So it's not this kind of sense of pinning it down to when was the day this was being fulfilled. I think this is the point. It may have had an original context, but it doesn't mean it won't continue to speak to us down the ages. And then potentially the last one. Where are we up to now in this present age regarding Revelation in terms of 2019? As I said, I wouldn't read the text in that way. I don't see it as kind of a timetable and we need to work out we're on chapter 20, verse 4 now. I don't read it in that way. Since I would read it as something that was emerging out of a first century context and speaks to us all through the ages, in that time between Christ's death and resurrection and his return. It's for that period. And the key thing is about worshipping God and imitating Christ. And that's what we should do in that in-between time. It's not about plotting on a calendar where we are in. We're on to chapter 20, verse 6 now. Next week we're going to get the locusts or something. I think that would be a misreader, personally. Is that right? Any other last questions that you maybe didn't want to write down? Or yeah?
Would you agree with what I'm saying, that they don't believe the Christ is the Messiah and he's still to come? And what you're saying, is he is coming?
Yeah, so this is the Book of Revelation, which is a Christian text. So the way, do you remember in Isaiah 6, where it had this image of the holy, 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 it is, and it had, and the earth is full of his glory. In Revelation's version, it had who he is, who was, and who comes. That's the Christian interpretation. So that's something that would be Christian, not Jewish. Although there's close connection with Isaiah, it's a reinterpretation of the life of Christ. It's understanding God in the life of Christ. How do we know more about God as a result of what's happened through Christ back in the resurrection? So again, Jewish people wouldn't accept the Book of Revelation, although they wouldn't see affinity with Isaiah.
Verse 7 and not 5 or 3?
I think it's that two things. One, it tends to be a number of wholeness or completeness. And also, I think ultimately, it's a bit like the Sabbath or the Lord's Day is on the seventh day. And I think it's this cycles of sevens. I think it's kind of, one scholar talked about another text called the Songs of the Sabbath Sacrifice, which is linked with worship on the Sabbath day, and it's full of sevens as well. And she talked about it being a rhapsody on the number seven. So I think that's what Revelation is. It's a rhapsody on the number seven in terms of the sacred day, the Lord's Day, the Sabbath day. It keeps coming round with this idea of the heavenly worship of God and the Lamb on the Lord's Day. This comes round and round. Excellent. I don't ask any more, I won't know the answers. But thank you all so much. You've been wonderful, really lovely group. Thank you for singing and joining in. Is end on the Messiah. You know, the very last chorus of the Messiah is chapter 5 of Revelation, the kind of praise of the Lamb. So I thought I'd put that on, and if everyone knows it, we can all sing along. But if you turn, oh, sorry, I've already put it in. It's just number 30. Okay.
I know you wanted to go on, but it's probably another 10 minutes. So I'd like to thank Sean so much for coming today and for a very stimulating presentation of the Apocalypse, the book that probably most of us say, oh, we don't read that one, we go back to the beginning. So it's been, I'm sure you're all going off to read at least selective passages from the Apocalypse now. So thank you so much, Sean, for giving your time. In a difficult and busy time of exams, all these exams and marking and all that stuff, so best of luck with that. Can I just say thank you to everyone who's organised today, Lucy in particular, but all of you who've helped. We do have something very special coming up on Wednesday week, which is David Manson talking about the liturgical year. And you probably say, well, I'm not really interested in that. If you're a reader, if you're a minister of the Eucharist, if you go to Mass, then you need to know about the liturgical year. And so many people don't. You know, think, oh, is it that feast today? Why is it that feast? If you want the answer to all those questions, David Manson will be coming on Wednesday night, Wednesday week, 12th of June at 7 o'clock. It won't be hot on that day, it's not going to be hot or thunder or anything like that. So please come to support us then. You will perhaps have heard that the bishops, in their great wisdom, have decreed that next year, from about September to about November 2020, will be a year of listening to the Word of God. And think, oh, do something about that. So if we haven't got your emails, please give us the email before you go, because we'll send you all the information in good time. You can put all the dates in your diary about what's going to be going on here and other places. Thank you very much. I've missed something, but I haven't done it deliberately. Thank you, and nice journey home. Thank you.
Thank you.